Hi everyone. So now moving on to the next topic of group 16, that is ozone. You all know, you have heard about ozone, depletion of ozone. It's a threat to us, isn't it? The UV radiations coming out from the ozone hole, etc. So now we will see more in detail about ozone. Okay, now ozone means O3. Okay, we write it as O3. It's an allotrope of oxygen. And you know, the ozone is formed about 20 kilometers above the atmosphere when it reacts with oxygen plus sunlight. Okay, when sunlight reacts with oxygen, ozone is formed and a layer is formed in order to prevent the ultraviolet radiations coming into Earth's atmosphere. So that is the use of ozone, and you know that part. So now coming to the preparation of ozone. Okay, how will you prepare ozone? You know, ozone is prepared by O2 plus O will give you O3. Or if ozone is simply, you can write it as, when a low stream of oxygen is passed through a silent electric discharge. See, when a slow stream of oxygen is passed through a silent electric discharge, this ozone is getting converted to, oxygen is getting converted to ozone. That is 2O3, this is 3O2. So what is the preparation? How the ozone is prepared? The prepared by passing a very low stream of oxygen when a silent electric discharge is set up, then this oxygen is converted to ozone. And it takes place at 25 degrees Celsius. At room temperature, and as well as the delta H is equal to plus 142 or 141 kilojoule per mole. If the delta H is positive, which means that it is an endothermic reaction. Okay, so this is an endothermic reaction. This ozone is formed, and this ozone is called as ozonized oxygen. What is it? Ozonized. Ozonized. Ozonized oxygen. Okay, so this is called as ozonized oxygen. So when electric discharge is set up between a silent flow of oxygen, ozone is formed. Now this ozone, we got only 10% of ozone is formed from this reaction. We can only get 10% of ozone from this reaction. Now why an electric discharge is set up? Because if electric discharge is not set up, then there is a decomposition takes place. So that is why this silent electric discharge is taken. Okay. So if we want a 90% ozone, this only you get the 10% ozone. If you want to get 90% of ozone, you have to use the battery of ozonizers. You have to use batteries of ozonizers. Okay, so then you will get 90% of ozone. In this method, you will get only 10% of ozone. So this is the preparation of ozone. Got it? So when the electric discharge is passed through a low flow of oxygen, you will get ozone, and this is 10% of ozone. You call it as ozonized oxygen. If you want to get 90%, you will have a batteries of ozonizers where you will get 90% of ozone. And since it's an endothermic reaction, you have to put it in electric discharge, otherwise decomposition happens, it gets back to oxygen. Okay, so that is why you have to get an electric, silent electric discharge. So this is about the preparation of ozone. Now we will move on to the properties of ozone. You know, very pure ozone, very pure ozone is pale blue in color, which is a which is a gas. When you take about ozone as a gas, it is a very pale blue in color. Now if you talk about a very pure ozone as a liquid, it is dark blue in color. And when you talk about ozone as a gas, it is purple or violet in color. It's a solid. And this is a liquid and this is gas. That is pure ozone. And you know, when ozone has got a very what a pungent smell. This color, it is color, and also it is having a pungent smell. And if it is inhaled in a lesser quantity, there is no harm in that. But if the concentration of ozone is more than 100 ppm parts per million, if you inhale the ozone, if the concentration of the ozone inhaled is greater than 100 ppm parts per million, then it is dangerous. You will have nausea or headache or something like that. So higher percentage of inhalation of ozone is harmful to health, but a lower percentage is not problem, no problem at all. Okay, that is about the property of ozone. Now, thermodynamically speaking, if we want to speak about ozone's thermodynamic stability, it is thermodynamically unstable. And we know how it is thermodynamically unstable. The ozone will go back to oxygen plus O. See, the ozone will decompose to form this oxygen plus O, and the liberation of a negative, that is exothermic reaction. The delta H is negative. That is the decomposition. It is thermodynamically unstable in the sense ozone gets converted into oxygen as well as the this oxygen O2 plus this OC in bracket I put, isn't it? And this is called as nascent oxygen. It's very very reactive in nature. Nascent oxygen, which is the cause of bleaching and all. You can have this nascent oxygen. Very reactive in nature because it is unstable. So thermodynamically speaking, the ozone is unstable. That means it decomposes to form this oxygen plus O, and the delta H is negative. It's a highly exothermic reaction. And you know, thermodynamically means delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. You know that Gibbs equation. So this equation you call it as a spontaneous equation if the delta G is negative. And if you see this equation, you know delta H is negative, it comes as negative, isn't it? So this is negative and the delta S is positive. The entropy is positive for this reaction. So altogether adding it, you will get the delta G as negative, which means that it is thermodynamically feasible, or this reaction is spontaneous in nature. You got the point? This reaction is spontaneous in nature, which means the delta G value becomes negative. How negative? The delta H is negative because it is exothermic reaction, the decomposition, and the delta S value is positive. Considering these two values, you will get a negative value overall, which states that this reaction is thermodynamically feasible or it happens spontaneously. Correct? Okay, so this is the thermodynamic stability. And you see, you have getting this nascent oxygen here. So since nascent oxygen is produced from the decomposition of ozone, this ozone can be said as a very very powerful oxidizing agent. What is it? Very very powerful oxidizing agent. Which means that it can oxidize the compounds. For example, so why it is called as an oxidizing agent? If a question asked, why ozone, or can you give an example to show the oxidizing property of ozone? Now why it is oxidation? Which means ozone will come back to O2 plus O. Due to the formation of this nascent oxygen has a capacity for oxidation. So that is why you call O3 as a very very powerful oxidizing agent. For example, it will oxidize lead sulfide plus O3. You will get lead sulfate. It oxidizes lead sulfide to sulfate plus O3 oxidized, which is reduced to O2. Okay. Or yet one more example is, it will iodide ion. Iodide ion will oxidize us in presence of water. We just balance it. Okay. And just leaving that, we balance it. It will form I2 is oxidized. I minus gets oxidized to I2. See? Plus O2 plus OH minus. So these are the two reactions. Study any one of the reaction which proves that ozone is a very very powerful oxidizing agent. Now why it is powerful oxidizing agent? Because it forms nascent oxygen. It forms nascent oxygen. That is why it is called as thermodynamically unstable, because it is highly exothermic reaction. The delta G is negative. It is feasible. So this reaction happens. Correct? Okay. Now study any one of these with equation balance. That means it can oxidize. See, if the question is asked, write an equation to show the oxidizing property of ozone. You can write this equation. It oxidizes lead sulfide to lead sulfate, isn't it? So plus O2, then or iodide ion to iodine. Okay, so this is the oxidation property. Okay. Now another important thing for in the case of ozone is, you can estimate ozone quantitatively. What is it? You can estimate the amount of ozone present. Estimate, that is quantitative estimation. You can estimate the ozone quantitatively. In board exam, repeated question is there. How is ozone estimated quantitatively? It's a question. So how can we observe, or how can we get or estimate the ozone quantitatively? Listen. The technique is, when this ozone is made to react with potassium iodide solution, listen, when ozone is treated with potassium iodide solution, which is buffered with, buffered means what? You have studied buffer solution, where the pH is not getting altered by using any acid or alkali. That is a buffer solution. So what is that buffer? It is called as a borate buffer. You know borax and all, no? So this is a borate buffer. So when O3, ozone is treated with potassium iodide, which is buffered with a borate buffer. Borate buffer means the buffer solution is borate, which the pH is greater than 9.7, basic in nature. What will happen? The iodide is formed. The Ki, the I minus oxidation, O3, powerful oxidizing agent, oxidizes the I minus to the iodine. And this iodine we can estimate with volumetry. We can estimate with a standard solution of sodium thiosulfate. See? So this is how you can estimate oxygen quantitatively, which means how much amount of ozone, oxygen, no, ozone. Ozone is there in this reaction, you can estimate. So first you have to have this reaction. Ozone, it react with potassium iodide. In presence of a buffered solution, the buffer is borate buffer of having a pH of 9.7 or 9.2, then iodine is formed. And this formed iodine should be volumetrically titrated using a standard solution, that means the non-solution of sodium thiosulfate. So this is non-solution, this you will get. So by this we will get how much amount of ozone you are taking. That is quantitative estimation of ozone. This is very, very important. Once again I will tell you, when ozone is reacted with potassium iodide, buffered with borate buffer, pH is 9.7 or 9.2, the iodine is liberated. And the liberated iodine should be volumetrically analyzed by a standard solution of sodium thiosulfate. Yes, here also you have the volumetric titration against the more salt and the oxalic acid. You will do it. Okay. So this is how you go for an estimation of quantitative estimation of ozone. So clear? So first we study the preparation of ozone by a silent electric discharge from by oxygen. You will get 10% ozone. 90% ozone, if you use batteries of ozonizers, you will get 90% of ozone. Now why you want a silent electric discharge, otherwise decomposition happens, isn't it? So that is about this preparation of ozone. And coming to the properties, it can have a pure ozone, can have exist in three states, that is solid, liquid and gas. The gas means it's a pale blue color, liquid means it's a dark blue color, and if it is solid, it is violet color. Now, the ozone, when it is inhaled, it is a pungent smell, right? When it is inhaled in a very little quantity, it is harmless. But if the concentration is above 100 ppm, parts per million, then it will cause some dizziness or headache or something. It is not good for health. Then coming to thermodynamic stability, it is thermodynamically unstable. Delta H is minus exothermic. Delta G is again minus the feasibility. The nascent oxygen is produced. Since the nascent oxygen is produced, it is said to be a very, very powerful oxidizing agent. It oxidizes the lead sulfate to lead sulfide to lead sulfate, or iodide to iodine. Now, how you will estimate this ozone quantitatively? By treating with potassium iodide in a borate buffer, pH of 9.7, you will get iodine. The liberated iodine is volumetrically analyzed by a standard solution of sodium thiosulfate. Correct. So this is how you estimate this ozone. And now one more thing in ozone is, the study says that ozone very well react with the nitric oxides, oxides of nitrogen, especially nitric oxide, this ozone reacts very well. And this is one of the major reason where this supersonic jet planes, no? You have heard of that, we have seen that, the supersonic jet planes, in that exhaust of the supersonic jet planes, it contains the oxides of nitrogen. And what happens? These oxides of nitrogen, particularly this nitric oxide, react with this ozone, and there it will cause a depletion in the ozone layer. That is disadvantage. The supersonic exhaust air from the supersonic jet planes will react with this nitric oxide, especially to cause a depletion or a hole in the ozone. So that is dangerous to the ozone layer. And also the dangerous situation of ozone is, it is from ozone, it is seen in freons. It is seen in freons, that is in spray, aerosol spray, or the refrigerants. These are all the damaging the ozone layer, which comes to the atmosphere. All these things will cause the depletion of this ozone layer. Okay. Then the last is, the structure of ozone. What is the structure of ozone? What is the structure of ozone? You know, O, O, then it's a double bond. Okay, O3. Now here Lewis structure, 2, 4, 6, 8 octet, 2, 4, 6, 8 octet, 2, 4, 6, 8. So this is the structure of ozone. Now this is in resonance with, what is the structure, resonance structure? That is, here is double bond, here is this single bond. 2, 2, 4, 6, 8. So, this is the Lewis structure. So, which means that all the, these two bonds are equivalent. Which means that these two canonical structures are same. It is called as resonance hybrid. Okay, the bond length are same in these two cases, which is called as, there are two resonance structures. This is resonance structure 1 and this is resonance structure 2. Okay, and the bond length is approximately, I think, 172 picometer. Just I don't know where the exact, but the both the bond length are same. Refer to the textbook. Okay, so this is all about the ozone. And its uses, if you speak about the uses, it is used in germicide or disinfectant, or then sprays, then so many uses of ozone. Okay, then sterilizing water, ozone is used in sterilizing water. So please study 2-3 uses if question comes. Okay. So that's all about ozone. So you got it, ozone clear? Okay. So two or three questions can come. So please study carefully. Now the oxygen is over. Now we will pass on to the next element, that is sulfur. Okay. We will have sulfur. So starting with sulfur, you know, sulfur, there are two main allotropes are there. Sulfur. Normally you will put it as SA, but sulfur, if you talk about the allotropes of sulfur, two allotropes are there. One is rhombic sulfur, and second is monoclinic sulfur. Monoclinic sulfur, or rhombic you call it as alpha sulfur, and monoclinic you call it as beta sulfur. So two types, more than two types are there, but for your listening only two are given, that is alpha and beta. Alpha sulfur is called as rhombic sulfur, and monoclinic sulfur is called as beta sulfur. And rhombic sulfur is yellow in color. Okay, yellow in color, and rhombic sulfur, I mean monoclinic sulfur, it is colorless. Okay. Now we will see how you prepare this rhombic sulfur and monoclinic sulfur. And the stable form of sulfur at room temperature is rhombic sulfur. Okay. Now from the rhombic sulfur, we prepare monoclinic sulfur. Okay. That means when monoclinic sulfur, when this monoclinic sulfur is heated to 369 Kelvin, when this rhombic sulfur is heated to 369 Kelvin, you will get the monoclinic sulfur. Now we will see one by one, that is about the rhombic sulfur as well as the monoclinic sulfur. Now how will you prepare rhombic, that means LO, rhombic sulfur or alpha sulfur. Okay. This is the stable form of sulfur. Now it is prepared by treating the sulfur, the rolled sulfur, you will get the rolled sulfur, no? Is dissolved in carbon disulfide. That means this sulfur first to dissolve within carbon disulfide and we evaporate it. Or on evaporating the rolled sulfur in carbon disulfide, you will get the alpha sulfur. It is a simple preparation. When sulfur when dissolved in carbon disulfide, you on evaporating it, you will get the yellow crystals of the sulfur, which is called as rhombic sulfur. Okay. Now, it very well dissolves in carbon disulfide, but it is insoluble in water. This alpha sulfur or rhombic sulfur is insoluble in water, but it is very well soluble in carbon disulfide. Okay. But the solubility of this rhombic sulfur in alcohol or ether is not much. It's sparingly soluble in alcohols or ether, but it is very well soluble in carbon disulfide and it is insoluble in water. Okay. Now the next point is, this rhombic sulfur or the alpha sulfur, I said earlier, when it is heated at 369 Kelvin, when this alpha sulfur is heated at 369 Kelvin, beta sulfur is formed or monoclinic sulfur is formed. Which means that below the 369 Kelvin, alpha sulfur exists, and above the 369 Kelvin, beta sulfur exists. So we call this temperature, the 369 Kelvin, as transition temperature. What is it? Transition temperature. So of rhombic sulfur or monoclinic sulfur, that is 369 Kelvin. Below 369 alpha exists, above 369 beta exists. So this is the preparation of rhombic sulfur or yellow rhombic sulfur or alpha sulfur. That is simple evaporation of this rolled sulfur, rolled sulfur in carbon disulfide. You just evaporate, you will get alpha sulfur. If you want to convert it into beta or monoclinic, you heat it at 369, very very important, the transition temperature, you heat it, you will get the monoclinic sulfur. It is insoluble in water, it is very well soluble in carbon disulfide, but it is sparingly soluble in alcohols or ethers or organic solvents like benzene. It is sparingly soluble. Clear? Now we will move on to beta sulfur or monoclinic sulfur. Okay, we will see how monoclinic sulfur is prepared. You know, when this rhombic, from the rhombic sulfur, you will get the monoclinic sulfur, isn't it? Now, the preparation is, you take a crucible, a china dish, and you have this alpha sulfur or rhombic sulfur, okay. Then you dissolve it in carbon disulfide. It is very well soluble in carbon disulfide. Then you evaporate it. Okay, now what you should do? You take carbon disulfide, alpha sulfur or rhombic sulfur when dissolved in carbon disulfide. First you evaporate it and then you suddenly cool it. First what you should do? You should evaporate and then you suddenly cool it. Then what will happen is, there is a crust formed in above this layer. So that means a thick layer formed in this crucible. A thick layer formed in this crucible. Okay. Now what you should do? You make two holes in this crust. It means a thick layer of substance. You make two holes and you pour off the remaining liquid in this crucible. You got it? First you take carbon, you take this rhombic sulfur, you pour carbon disulfate and dissolve in it. First you evaporate it and then suddenly you will cool it. Then you have a crust on the upper side of that. You put two holes in it and you took holes with pin. It's like pin, you put two holes, very small holes. You pour the remaining liquid out and then you cut off this crust from that crucible. You will see very, very crystals, very shiny, beautiful crystals of colorless monoclinic sulfur. That is how you prepare monoclinic sulfur. Okay, so a crust is formed. You break that crust, you make two holes, then leave this remaining liquid, then you take out the crust, you will get the needle-shaped colorless monoclinic sulfur. Okay, needle-shaped monoclinic sulfur. And you know what is the transition temperature? That is the temperature where the rhombic sulfur gets converted into monoclinic sulfur. Then coming to more about on the shape of the structure or the atomicity of structure, then both the rhombic as well as the monoclinic are SI molecules. Both the monoclinic as well as the rhombic are SI molecules, of which the stable you call it as round shaped structure. See, both the rhombic as well as the monoclinic are having an SI molecule where there is a stable shape which is called as a crown shape. Listen, I will draw it for you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. See, the sulfur atom is in the form of a crown and this is the stable structure. That means the repulsions are all minimum. So this is a stable structure that is called as a crown shaped structure for both SI molecules of monoclinic as well as rhombic. Again, there are S6 molecules. See, S6 molecules are there, S6 molecules. Actually, from S6 to S20 are reported. In the case of S6 molecule, there is again a stable conformation. These are called as conformation. Okay, you will study that. Conformations, which is called as a chair shaped conformation. You see, 6, no? 1. It is in the form of a chair. Yes, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and 6. See, 6. Two types are there. One is board shape, and other is chair shape. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Two conformations in the case of S6 molecule. One is chair shape conformation and other is boat shape conformation. See, out of which the chair shape conformation is more stable because of the minimum repulsion. And this is stable, but when compared to this boat shape, this chair shape conformation of S6 molecule is more stable. We talked about S8 molecule, that is crown shaped. Now again one more is there. At higher temperature, that is more than 1000 degree, see, more than 1000 degree, there is the sulfur molecule at elevated temperatures or more than 1000 degree, this sulfur molecule exists as S2, that means in the vapor state. See, in above 1000 degrees Celsius, the sulfur molecule exists as S2, not S6 or a S8. It exists as S2, that is in the gaseous state. And the important property of this S2 is, this is paramagnetic. See, this is paramagnetic in nature. That means it contains unpaired electrons in the pi star antibonding orbital. You know, right? Bonding antibonding orbital. That's a board question. Why S2 is paramagnetic in nature? Why? Because at elevated temperatures, sulfur exists as in the vapor state or the gaseous state as S2 molecules. And these S2 molecules are paramagnetic in nature. What is paramagnetism? Which contains unpaired electrons. What is diamagnetism? Shared pair of electrons. So this is paramagnetic because it contains two unpaired electrons. To be very specific, it contains two unpaired electrons in pi star anti bonding orbital. Chemical bonding. You have pi and pi star, sigma and sigma star. So, and both bonding as well as anti bonding. This is bonding and this is star is anti bonding. So, two unpaired electrons are there in pi star anti bonding orbital. That is why this is called as a, this exists in paramagnetism. This exhibit paramagnetism. Clear? So, this is about this sulfur. So, you got it? You have an idea about the sulfur? Two types of sulfur, that is rhombic sulfur as well as monoclinic. The preparation of rhombic as well as monoclinic. Then, the conformations, that is the molecules, how it exists as molecules. S8 molecules, that is crown shaped, is a stable one. Even though it contains S6 to S20, S6 is more stability. Two types, that is boat shaped and chair shaped. Out of which the chair shape is more stable. Then coming to S2, at temperature higher than 1000, it exists in vapor state S2, which is paramagnetic in nature. So this is about the sulfur or the allotropes of sulfur. Okay. Then next is, you will see sulfur